Welcome to the fifth day of this Spanish part of the 2015 Winter Universiade. The sights of the Sierra Nevada proving to be just as spectacular at night as they are by day. On the menu, the two remaining unbeaten teams in the women's curling go head-to-head as Canada slide into action against Sweden. We have the second part of the women's super combined competition from Sierra Nevada as the slalom specialists look to make up ground on the speed merchants. We have a heavyweight clash from the men's ice hockey's 10-time champions Russia face off against defending champions Canada, with top spot in Group B at stake. The best student athletes in the world, providing inspiration for our future generations. Start at the Fuentenueva Pavilion with the fourth round of matches from the ladies' curling competition. And this a big matchup between the two teams, still with an unbeaten record after three matches. That's Canada against Sweden. To the first end, Canada with the hammer. This is the first stone from Swedish skip Sarah McManus. Looking slightly concerned here, trying to stun into the house off of the Canadian stone. Getting too thin a contact though, her own stone going out of the back of the house. So Brianne Meakin, the Canadian skip, with her first effort of the match. Her task, a relatively simple one, just trying to draw this stone around that front guard put in place by the Swedes. Perfectly done as well. Just in front of the button there from Meakin. So going round to the left-hand side instead for Sarah McManus. And straight away, something perhaps amiss, heavy sweeping going on. And they already know at this stage that they're going to bump into that front guard. Big mistake in the first end from the Swedes then, and now a relatively simple task for Meakin. Another simple draw. Meakin, a silver medalist in the 2009 Junior World Championships, with a whole new team this year. Not letting that put her off her stride though. Perfectly done, and a perfect start for Canada. 2-0 up after the first end. The Swedes did get one back with the hammer in the second. So 2-1 down, but the Canadians with the hammer in the third leg. Just trying to bump that front stone onto that scoring Canadian stone. Missing though, and only managing to put her own stone out the back of the house. Similar shot here attempted by Meakin then with her final stone of the end. Again, just trying to nudge her front stone into a scoring position. Just going for the angle off her stone at the front left of the house. And perhaps just catching it too thin. So the Canadians definitely scoring one. Plenty of discussion over some of the other stones still in the house. Three stones in it, one Swedish and two Canadian stones. The referee first measuring the Swedish stone, swinging round, having a look here. So close, but no cigar for the Canadians with that stone. Good to have a look at this one as well, and again just away. And by the narrowest of margins, Canada restricted to just the one in the third end. Going into a 3-1 lead, pegged back to 3-2 in the fourth end. We now move to the fifth end. This McManus's final stone of the end, trying to check into the centre of the house. Off that Canadian stone on the right-hand side. Again, though, another mistake. Too thin, out of the back. And now a really big target for Meakin to aim at. heavy sweeping going on, but now they're pretty happy with their work, the Canadians. That stone drifting just over the back of the button, good enough though. A double for Canada, and they moved into a 5-2 lead at the midway stage of this match. Sweden again managed to score a single in the sixth end to get it back to 5-3. But now to the seventh end, and things looking dire indeed for the Swedes. The Canadians really building up a presence in the house. As you can see there, this a fourth stone being put into scoring position. Perhaps a little shorter than ideal. So there is a shot here for Sarah McManus. Using more pace this time, trying to stun off that last stone from the Canadians and then come across to the left at an angle and take out those other two stones. Just caught the initial stone too thick and only brushed those Canadian stones, so they're already lying three, and now a simple draw for Brianne Meakin. And there would be no mistakes here from the Canadian team. Already looking pretty happy with this one. Just some light brushing, that going straight onto the button. A four scored for Canada, 9-3 ahead. The Swedes then deciding enough is enough, even with three ends remaining. Canada now with a 4-0 record after four matches. The Swedes, though, still looking good for the knockout stages with a 3-1 record after a 9-3 Canadian win. Now to alpine skiing and the second leg of the women's super combined. A slalom run down the Universiade piste, cloudy conditions greeting the skiers as they attempted to negotiate the 51 turns ahead of them. Sakuraku Mukogawa of Japan was 26th after the first run, over 2.5 seconds behind the leader. She didn't even finish the Super G on Friday, looking much better in the slalom segment. And she would finish with the fastest slalom time of all, 46.18 seconds, easily into first place at that moment. Oljana Gantnerova of Slovakia, 22nd after the first run, just under half a second faster than Mukogawa. She was 21st in Friday's Super G competition. Also looking much better in the more technical discipline, 46.36 seconds. That would be the third fastest slalom run and put her ahead of Mukogawa and into first place for the moment. What Yulia Bayalo of Spain, just 19 years of age, 20th on the first run, over 2 seconds off the lead, 22nd in the Super G on Friday. Another one looking much more at home on the shorter skis. Good attack here, very smooth. Good through the transition as well, and she would finish with 46.64 seconds. That's the seventh fastest of the slalom times, but 0.21 behind Gantnerova and into second place. Maren Bjørklund of Norway, 16th on the first run. About a third of a second in hand over Gantnerova. Eighth in the Super G on Friday. Not really happy with her first run in the combined. Much happier in the slalom though. Recovering from that mistake well to record a 46.35 seconds, the second fastest of all the competitors down the slalom, putting her into first pace by nearly half a second. Victoria Martel-Stevens of Canada from the University of Montreal was 15th off the first run. She only had 0.06 of a second in hand over Bjørklund. 16th in the Super G. Putting in another solid run here. 12th fastest, in fact, from the slalom, 47.5 seconds. Only good enough for fifth place at that point. I'm only going to drop further down the standings. Well, Kristin Fausa Asberg of Norway, 12th after the first run, gold medalist in the Super G on Friday. One of the favourites for a medal here. A 20-year-old really attacking the slalom part of this competition. Great balance and poise. Attacking well. Much faster after a disappointing Super G. 46.62, sixth in the slalom. Only second for the moment. A chance, though, of another medal. Just 0.01 of a second behind a compatriot, Pavla Klishnerova of the Czech Republic. Fifth after the first run. In a very strong position for a medal. She was fourth in the downhill and tenth in the Super G in the 2013 Universiade in Trentino. 13th in the Super G on Friday as well. Getting a bit twisted there. Plenty of time in hand though. 47.27. Enough to put her into first place by 0.15 of a second ahead of Bjorklund. Well, Daria Shinikova of Russia, just 19 years of age, third after the first run. Seventh in the Super G on Friday. Again, very balanced through the middle of the run. Not the tidiest though, but 47.31, enough to put her into the lead, 0.26 ahead of Klishnerova. Now then, Maria Bedarova of Russia, 22-year-old, second after the first run, fifth in the Super G on Friday. A real speed merchant though, and you can see that here. Not so comfortable in the technical discipline, scrubbing off too much speed through these turns, not keeping her momentum. Just lacking a little bit of the technique as well of some of her competitors. 17th fastest, in fact, in the slalom. Obviously not her forte. And she would end up in a share of ninth place. Well, Karina Szczepek of Poland, a big favourite. Leader after the first run. Silver medal in Friday's Super G to go with her silver from the Super G from 2 years ago in Trentino. And a bronze in a downhill as well in Italy. Hot favourite, but missing a gate. Absolute disaster for the 25-year-old. The hot favourite out. Daria Shinikova of Russia takes the gold ahead of Schnarnova and Bjorklund. Finally, to the big clash from the men's ice hockey competition as defending champions Canada faced off against 10-time champions Russia, the Granada Sport Palace. At stake, top spot in Group B, both teams coming into the match having won their opening two matches. Canada having put 11 goals past South Korea before also finding the net 7 times in their second match against Sweden. Russia, meanwhile, struggled to impress in their opening 5-1 win over the Swedes, but then really cut loose with 13 goals against group whipping boys South Korea. These two teams have also previously contested 4 Universiade finals between them. The Canadians coming out on top in 1991 and 2007, while the Russians struck gold in 1972 and 2009. 14 Universiade titles between them and no love lost either. A scene set for this mouth-watering clash between the two title favourites here in Granada. The Canadians enjoying the first real sighted goal. Tyler Fiddler with a stinging slap shot, but easily fielded by Gleb Evdokimov. However, it was the Russians that would open the scoring in the 8th minute. Alexander Lebedev finding acres of space on the left and putting the puck on a plate for Ivan Petrakov, net for the third time in Spain, just after the Canadians fended off a pair of power plays. The Canucks swiftly trying to get back on level terms though. Levko Koppa with the shot, but unable to get the better of the goaltender. The 13th minute, unlucky for some, in this case the defending champions, Artem Fedorov allowing too much time and space behind the net, making it all too easy to pick out the onrushing Rushan Rafikov, make it 2-0 with his first goal of the competition. Mikhail Klimchuk could even have made it 3-0, but the defence just about doing enough to put him off his shot. Into the second period then, and the Canadians finally got a much needed foothold in the match. Cruz Redick coming in from the right and reducing the deficit to 2-1. At his second goal of the tournament, owing a little to good fortune, as his scruffy shot hopped up and over the goaltender's leg. The Canadians with their tails up now and getting back on level terms, as Jordan Rowley's shot was allowed to break loose too close to the net, with Fiddler somehow playing the puck into the goal off the back of the goaltender. Having shipped two goals within less than 2 minutes of the restart, the Russians steadied themselves and then took the lead once again on one of their many power plays. Igor Krivchenko neatly controlling the puck with his skate, before doubling his tally here in Granada. Rafikov then allowed too much space on the left to try and grab his second goal of the match, but this time his shot was too close to Christopher Lazaruk. The Canadians then managed to get back on level terms again just before the end of the second period. Jesse Craig with a sumptuous flick into the top corner. The four-time champions on this occasion providing a perfect example of counter-attacking ice hockey with a clinical finish to match. Both sets of coaching staff feeling the heat in a hectic encounter, and Canada then took the lead for the first time in the match just 33 seconds into the final period. Craig with a fierce slap shot from distance, the puck ploughing through a crowd of players and into the net, with perhaps a small deflection off Nikita Cherepanov, the goaltender unsighted for that one. 4-3 became 5-3 5 minutes later. Rowley with the puck by the boards on the right and finding Fiddler and acres of space out on the left. The 24-year-old with another fierce finish for his second goal of the game, putting the Canadians into a 5-3 lead that they would never relinquish. The game degenerating into a flurry of penalties late on, the Canadian defence now resolute as they closed out to win over their fiercest of rivals. 5-3, the final score then, the Canadian defence largely to thank really, after only allowing one goal from 14 minutes of Russian power plays. The Russians also leading the shot count in every period bar the second, taking that stat overall 33-25. That's enough then to see Canada top of the group with a potentially easier route to the final, while Russia may need to progress via the playoffs.
Now when I was a little boy, we could have a lot of fun. I'm a man. I spell M A M. Oh, I'm a man.
Education meets sport and culture. What best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.